A coming COVID storm. That is how the mayor of Anchorage, Alaska, recently described the pandemic in his city as he announced new emergency orders restricting businesses and gatherings. As Stephanie Tsai reports, the unique geography of the last frontier state has not spared it from the pain.
Removed from other states, mostly wilderness, the pandemic took longer to gain a grip on Alaska. But now it has, in what officials have described as a rapid acceleration and exponential growth in cases. Summer is usually a boom time in Alaska for tourism and fishing, pillars of the economy that some locals worry will now expose them to an unwanted guest, the virus.
As a mother, you're always concerned for the safety of your children.
Desi Bond, who is Yupik, lives in Dillingham, a small town in the Bristol Bay region known for its sockeye salmon. During the summer fishing season, the population of some 7,000 residents doubles with seasonal workers.
My oldest and my youngest have asthma. You're always on the alert, you know, are they okay? Are they healthy? But then to have something come in that's so invisible and such a big threat to our lives and our livelihood, it's been very stressful.
We're going to be, you know, very careful all the way until the end of August, first part of September.
Thomas Tilden is a tribal leader and commercial fisherman in Bristol Bay.
The mayor of Dillingham and I had sent a joint letter to the governor asking him to postpone the fishery, cancel the fishery.
But other local officials, including Dan O'Hara, pushed to keep the fishery open, concerned about the economic hit.
And then you're sitting here and the community is broke, and we create another disaster upon that.
A compromise was worked out, and seafood companies took steps like testing seasonal workers before they could work that so far have prevented outbreaks in Bristol Bay. Not easy in canneries and fisheries where workers live together.
They put gates around their living quarters, gates around their facilities. Gotta give them credit for what they did to keep us all safe.
But other coastal fishing villages have not dodged the virus. Hundreds of seafood industry workers have tested positive. In Seward on the Kenai Peninsula, more than a third of workers at an OBI seafoods processing plant tested positive for COVID-19, forcing the plant to temporarily shut down. OBI Seafoods operates 10 processing plants across Alaska, staffed with both seasonal and local workers.
When you look at the remote facilities, like out in Bristol Bay and in the Kodiak on the far reaches, those are closed campuses. They don't leave, they don't interact with anyone in the communities.
Mark Palmer is CEO of the company. He says they work with local officials to keep tabs on any employees who test positive.
Where you have some local workforce, those employees come and go back and forth to home every day. So they're certainly not required to stay on campus, but we try and keep them as separate as possible inside the facilities.
In addition to fishing, the tourism industry is vital to Alaska's economy. Cruise ships bring in $1 billion a year.
We went from that to, of course, almost nothing.
Vivian Mork owns Planet Alaska, a gallery that sells native-made goods in downtown Juneau. 1.4 million cruise tourists were projected to come through the port this summer before coronavirus canceled cruises.
We went from maybe doing well to all of a sudden trying to figure out how to keep the roof over our head and the food in their belly and the store open and bills being paid.
That loss in business has meant a huge drop in income for many Alaskans.
At the same time as it hits us economically, it also helped to protect us. Being inundated with positive cases.
They are far from being inundated, but cases have begun seeping in to even the most remote communities where there is extremely limited access to health care. Patients have been medevaced from places like Bethel in far west Alaska and Fort Yukon near the Arctic Circle, home of the Gwich'ije people.
We have lost our first tribal member, community member to COVID a few days ago.
Tribal council member Dacho Alexander says they did their best to keep their town isolated, but village and family life are remarkably interdependent, especially during the crucial peak fishing months.
The reality of village life is it requires multiple families in order to basically survive because you're having to put away food for the winter. We knew that there was a matter of time before it did get here, and we just try to hold it off as long as we can.
It's not clear how the virus got to Fort Yukon. The village was under a strict lockdown and curfews, but for a 10-day period in June when rules were relaxed.
Rural areas are intertwined economically with the larger communities.
Nathan McCowan is head of the St. George Tana Village Corporation. St. George is an island in the middle of the Bering Sea.
Once it gets into the rural communities, everybody understands the capacity and the medical realities about how dangerous it can be.
We're seeing some larger events occur now.
Dr. Robert Anders is the medical director at the Alaska Native Tribal Health Consortium. He says many Alaska Natives are at greater risk for severe impacts from COVID-19.
There's an increased burden of chronic disease, increased burden of smoking, increased burden of crowded housing, increased challenges with water and sewer access, and all those prevent incredible risks to the rural community.
Native Alaskans have survived in the face of many hardships, but not without taking devastating losses. The 1918 Spanish flu decimated many families, including Thomas Tilden's.
Apparently, someone brought that influenza into the village. One morning, there was no more relatives. They had all died that night. And so they lost a vast number of their village people.
That pandemic killed more than half of adults and elders across Alaskan villages. More recently, the 2009 H1N1 flu hit the region hard. Alaska's geography is both an opportunity and a vulnerability when it comes to COVID.
We want to rapidly identify and eradicate COVID in these rural communities, not a mitigation strategy. We really need to prevent it entering those communities.
But an eradication strategy may be too late. And when the summer fish harvest is over, Nathan McCowan worries the cold season brings new peril.
We can have seasonal storms that will ground all air travel for weeks.
By the numbers, Alaska has far fewer cases than other states, but Desi Bond says the burden is no different.
I know Alaska is a forgotten state. I know our people are overlooked, but we are here. We too are fighting to keep ourselves safe, to keep our families healthy.
Fighting an invisible enemy, as memories of devastating pandemics loom large in the minds of many Alaskan natives. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Stephanie Tsai.